Thank you for joining our broadcast today. We want you to be free to hear from God, and we pray that His blessing would be on your life. We're a church that's on mission across the aisle, across the street, and around the world. We believe the gospel changes everything. God bless.
Sing glory. and good morning. And if you want to be hot, just come on up here. It is warm up here this morning. Would you stand as we sing? Angels We Have Heard on High. Please stand as we continue in song this morning.
Angels We Oh, Good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you here today to First Baptist Alcoa. It is good to come together today and worship as a family. This chair looks awfully comfortable. I've been watching it the whole time. I kind of wanted to test it out. This is Freeman's new prestigious pastor's chair, right? No, I'm just kidding. Well, this morning, if you're a first-time guest, there's a little card in the pew in front of you. If you can just take that card and fill it out and toss it in the offering plate when it comes by, we would love to give you a gift just to show you our appreciation for coming. Well, this time, everyone go around and find someone to say good morning to. If you're sick, just give someone the elbow instead of shaking their hand, but find somebody that you haven't seen in a while this morning.
Coming to you live here at FBA for the 2012 block party here. We're getting a look here live with some of the folks helping us set up the food. Everybody's going through getting some food tonight, getting their bellies full so they can go back outside and have some fun. All right, I want to talk to these drink technicians tonight. How do you manage to fill all these cups with ice and just the right beverage for these folks to quench their thirst?
I'm just that good.
And now, Mr. Steve Self. Steve, how's it going tonight?
It's great. It's just a great team effort. Brock and I, we work so well together. It's been awesome to watch him work. I don't get to see that very often, but it's great.
Oh my gosh, look at Shelly Self. Bonus, we got the whole family here. What do you have here, Shelly? Is this tea?
This is our 15th gallon of pink lemonade. These people love pink lemonade.
You heard it here first. That's our 15th gallon of pink lemonade. Miss Shelly just brought it out. So we are serving a lot of lemonade tonight. Got a little guy here. I'm not sure what his name is, but he seems to be enjoying his barbecue tonight. Are you enjoying your food tonight, little man?
Yeah.
What's my name?
Dada.
What is it?
Dada.
Dada? I don't know you. I'm just kidding. This is Gray, and he's eating everything in sight because Gray likes to eat. And this is Caden Jay over here. Caden Jay, are you having fun? Are you getting enough to eat, buddy? We're making our way outside to see all the goings on outside, all the fun.
All right, we got Miss Susan Smith here with us tonight, and she looks all bundled up and happy. How many people would you estimate have come through already this evening?
I would say about 300, maybe.
300 already, that's awesome. All right, Miss Susan, wave to the camera and say, it's good to be here at the 2012 Block Party.
It's great to be here at the 2012 Block Party.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got Freeman Tomlin here at our first annual 2012 Block Party. And Freeman, just wanted to get your perspective and tell us how you think it's going tonight, and if you think maybe looking forward down the road, if it's something that our church will continue to host and to put on every year.
Well, I think it's been awesome tonight because we've just been able to meet our community, and the food, I'm telling you, and the fellowship is awesome. So we're going to keep doing stuff like this just to simply love and reach out to people.
This is Josh Livingston. We've had a great time here at the first annual FBA Block Party here in 2012. I've had an awesome time, and finally, they're going to let me do some playing. Let's do this.
From way downtown, bang.
What a wonderful video, what a wonderful time. Please stand as we continue in song with It Came Upon the Midnight Clear. Please stand.
Repent, O gracious King.
Thank you, and you can be seated.
Have your Bibles, if you'll turn to Luke, the first chapter. Luke chapter 1. Emmanuel has come, but the Bible says there's a forerunner. There's somebody who is jogging prior to Jesus, and it's critical to understand the saga of salvation that you must understand the birth of John before you can ever understand the birth of Jesus. These are two stories. Luke, the doctor, the physician, lays side by side. Luke chapter 1, verses 5 through 25. Merry Christmas, happy Hanukkah, Thanksgiving, everything. As I was coming to work today, or this is not work, this is a passion that I have. You may work at a job. This is stuff that I get to do, and they pay me for it. It's fun. I was getting ready to leave the house, and my wife looked at me, and she said, "You're dressing like an old geezer." And I thought, that's the spirit of the Antichrist, because I remember preaching on prophecy. And so I said, "What's wrong with yellow and tan?" And she said, "It's December." And I said, "It's 72 degrees. And then I saw Tom Moore's got the same shirt I have on. And anyway, Merry Christmas to you. Okay, Luke chapter 1, 5 to 25. If you'll stand out of honor and respect, that was for free. Honor and respect of God's word. You know, Emmanuel has come. But for Israel, it was a dark, 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 dark 400 years where God didn't say a word. And so from the end of Malachi to Luke, we see here the introduction of a forerunner. We see the prophecy that's arising here in Luke chapter 1, starting in verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. And his wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God. Your translation may say righteous, observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. But they had no children because Elizabeth was barren. And they were both well along in years. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as a priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him. This is breaking of the 400 years. The angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you're to give him the name John. He will be a joy and a delight, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel he will bring back to the Lord our God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can you be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife, she's well along in years." The angel answered, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not be able to speak until the day that this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed in so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, for he was kept making signs to them, but he remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home, and after his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." Father, this is your word that we come to. We submit, we say yes, because this is crazy promise in here. This is a crazy promise. This makes no sense whatsoever. It's absurd in our minds. Our finite minds cannot understand how this could be. How a man and his wife could bring forth a child as a forerunner to the Messiah makes no sense. And oftentimes, God doesn't make sense. Maybe you're here this morning and God doesn't make sense. Things that are happening in your life, it just doesn't make sense. The question is, can you trust a sovereign God that he's got everything under control? And Zechariah did not believe the words that God gave him through the angel Gabriel. Father, help us to have faith and trust and belief. Remove our doubt, because we know that fear and faith can't reign in the same heart. Teach us today the Christmas story, the Christ of Christmas, through Luke chapter 1, in Jesus' name, amen. So we see here in the text, it was in the time, Lord, it's the text,
Crazy promise. It's in the time of Herod, king of Judea. I don't have time to backdrop all of the wickedness of Herod, but I can tell you that Herod was a wicked man. He was a wicked king. He was a wicked ruler. In fact, he was so scared of this king being born that he slaughtered all the male children in Jerusalem under the age of two. Now, you talk about paranoia. That's a paranoid adult man because he's scared that a baby is going to take over and reign. So he's paranoid. And so he was a wicked king in the time. This is what the... See, in the unfolding of time, God has a plan. He brings beautiful promises by his sovereign hand. In fact, if you'll turn to Luke chapter 1, verse 78, just in the same chapter down at the end, it says, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven. See, Luke is talking about the coming of the Messiah there. That's the fulfilling of prophecy, that the sun rising has to do with the Messiah that's going to come. In fact, at the last book of the Old Testament, if you'll turn there to the book of Malachi, if you'll turn to the book of Malachi, it says this, that talks about, lays out that verse, chapter 1, verse 78. If you'll go to Malachi chapter 4, verse 2, it says, but for you who revere my name, the sun, S-U-N, of righteousness will rise with healing in its wings, and you will go out and leap like calves released from the stall. He's talking about the coming of the Messiah. Israel, look for the coming of the Messiah. But also, Luke talks about the forerunner who's going to come in Malachi. So if you look at Malachi chapter 3, look at there, Malachi chapter 3, you're going to see how this prophecy unfolds. See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple, and the messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. You see, what Luke is saying is there's a forerunner. After 400 years of silence, the last time that God has spoken has been silent. Israel has been in and out of apostasy. There were times when she was righteous, but she, in and out of apostasy. And so there's this roller coaster, and God has been silent, but God's about to break the dawn. He's about to remove the darkness. He's about to come in a way that nobody has expected him to come. And Luke the doctor details this for us, and he tells us in Luke chapter 1, he says it's in the time of Herod. It's in a time when a king was killing people and slaughtering people and murdering babies that this forerunner John is going to come. And you see, this forerunner is going to point to the Messiah. So you'll know who the Messiah is by who the forerunner points to. And John has to be born before Jesus. And so you have to understand here, you have to lay two stories side by side. The birth of John and the birth of Jesus. And so when you understand those two stories, when you understand the impact of Jesus in the manger, you have to understand that John was in Elizabeth's belly. And so when you understand that Mary is a virgin, you have to understand that Joseph was going to be the husband, a spouse. And you understand that Zechariah the priest is going to the temple to perform his priestly duties, and all of a sudden an angel is going to break the silence. For all of these years, God has been silent, but God's going to unfold the purpose and the plan, and the saga of salvation is going to come flying open in the midst of darkness. And that's the way God works. And it says here in verse 5, go back to the text, in the time of Herod, this is when it's coming, king of Judea, there was a priest, a certain priest. His name was Zechariah. He was just a priest among 18,000 priests. What they had in biblical days was they had 18,000 priests. And so what they had was 24 courses, 24 divisions. He was of the division of Abijah. And what would happen, a priest would be serving in the temple 2 weeks out of the year. 2 weeks out of the year. They had so many priests, they would serve 2 weeks out of the year. And so Zechariah was just a certain priest, just a humble man. You've got Herod, who's a wicked man. You've got Zechariah, who's just a humble man. He belongs to the priestly division of Abijah. Doesn't say he's a descendant of Abijah. It says that he is just a certain priest. Now, all the priests for history came out of the line of Aaron, okay? Aaron had two sons, Eleazar and Ithamar, and everything came out of Aaron's loins, okay? All of the priestly line came out of there. So so Ithamar and Eleazar, they had sons, and then they had more sons, and their sons, and their sons, and their sons, so you've got this long line of priestly influence. And so Zechariah is a priest, a certain priest, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. Now, Secondly, and his wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Aaron's wife was Elizabeth, so she has the same name, and so we have an understanding here that not only do you have this priestly division, but you have a wife who understands the priestly duties, who understands the religion of that day, and so they're carrying on in their normal activity, the normal routine that they would normally go through, and in the midst of that, God is going to shine his light, God is going to break through in the darkness, God is going to show himself and saying, I've got a son and a savior who's going to come at this time, and I've been silent for 400 years, but not anymore. God's going to break the silence. We see that in Luke 1:78, Malachi 3, Malachi 4, and there's a forerunner who's coming onto the scene. Now, I want you to notice the text. Here's what it says about who they are. Verse 6. Both of them, not one of them, both of them were righteous in the sight of God. They were righteous. They were upright, the text says, in the sight of God, observing all the commandments and the regulations blamelessly. Now, how did you become righteous? You see, God has to reckon righteousness to you. And in Genesis 15:6, it says, and Abraham believed, and it was counted unto him as a righteousness. So people in the Old Testament were saved because it was credited unto them as righteousness. They were looking forward to the day when Messiah would come, when they understood the fulfillment of the promises, and they were pointing toward the cross. Where we look back, they looked forward to it. And so the only way that a man and or a woman could be counted righteous was for God to impute his righteousness to them by faith. You see, they knew the law. They knew all of the law. They knew that they needed mercy. They knew that they needed grace. They understood Genesis chapter 15, verse 6. They understood that righteousness was a covering. That's the idea in the text. It's just a covering. God covers you with righteousness. Remember, we've been talking about the last couple of weeks about righteousness. Righteousness is everything that Jesus is. And righteousness is a gift that we receive by faith. Just like in the Old Testament, righteousness is not something you work for. Righteousness is something that you are because of who Jesus is. So when you trust Jesus as your Savior and you give your heart to Him, He imputes righteousness to you and He also imparts righteousness to you so you can live a life that's pleasing unto Him. So if you want to know who Zacharias and Elizabeth are, these are two people who were doing what they were supposed to be doing when they were supposed to be doing it, and they were righteous in the sight of God. God looks at the heart. Man looks at the outside. That's what man does. You see, you look so nice today. And man said, well, that's so, you look so good. Listen, God does, He looks through all the clothes you're wearing and says, listen, I'm looking at your heart. I'm looking to see if I have imputed righteousness to you. So that's the kind of people I want to submit to you. This is the kind of people God uses. He uses righteous people, and that's who they were. They were righteous in the sight of God. You see, people, the Pharisees, the hypocrites, they wanted to be righteous before men. Look at me. Look at how I pray. Judge me by all this. Listen, that has nothing to do with righteousness. Righteousness is who and whose you are. And so if you belong to Jesus Christ, positionally you are righteous, and then when you begin to walk that out, practically you are righteous in the way that you live. These two people were righteous in the sight of God. So they looked forward, these promises that they believed, these crazy promises. Turn to Isaiah 61:10. Isaiah 61:10 and 53, 4 through 6. They knew these scriptures. They knew these scriptures. They pointed to the day when the Savior would die for the sins of the world. They knew the law. They knew they needed to be saved. They cried out for mercy. Isaiah 61:10. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for He, look at it, whoa, this is beautiful. He has clothed me with a garment of salvation and arrayed me in the robe of righteousness as a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. Oh, they knew this. Zacharias and Elizabeth, they knew that righteousness was a robe that they wore. You see, so I would ask you, what kind of garment are you wearing today? Are you wearing the garment of Christ? Are you wearing the garment of righteousness? Or are you wearing the filthy garment of your works? Here's what he says, Isaiah, look back at 53. Isaiah 53, 4 to 6. Zacharias and Elizabeth, they knew this. Not only did they understand Genesis 15, 6, Isaiah 61:10, but they knew 53, 4 through 6. Surely He took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered Him stricken by God, smitten by Him and afflicted. But He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each one of us has turned to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Turn back to Luke. That's what they believed. That's what God was using. Two people who believed in the Messiah, who had their hearts pointed toward the future. And they had righteousness counted unto them, credited unto them. And so here's what it says. So they were righteous in the sight of God, observing, whoa, here it is, all the commandments and regulations blamelessly. Doesn't say they were perfect. Says they were blameless. You see, blameless has to do with upright. And so they were blameless with the Lord. Because you see, once God imputes righteousness to you as a gift, then he imparts righteousness to you in order to walk. So their talk and their walk, they matched up. How would it be in churches across America if lost people couldn't say how hypocritical we were in this room? See, that's why we don't reach the lost world. Because people see the way you and I live at times, and they say, oh, wait a minute. They say they're this, but they act like this. Their talk and their walk does not connect. It does not match. But I want you to know, in this text, it says that Zacharias and Elizabeth, not only were they upright and righteous, but they walked blamelessly. They weren't perfect, but they honored the Lord. They sought the Lord. They worshiped the Lord. There was a consistency in what came out of their mouth and what their feet were moving toward. And here's the embarrassment of their life, verse 7. But they had no children. Because you see, back in that day, if you didn't have children, you were looked at as somebody who had sin in your life. There was something wrong with you. You were an embarrassment to society. And so if you couldn't have children, they would say, what have you done wrong? Why is God punishing you? And so there was a stigma if you didn't have children back in that day. And so although they were righteous in the sight of God, they were not righteous in the sight of man, because man looked at them and said, there's something wrong with you. What's wrong with you? What have you done? What sin have you committed to have this come upon you? And so it says there, they had no children. Because Elizabeth was barren and they were both well along in years. Do you know what that means? Basically, Zacharias, and he says this in one particular, he says, my wife is old. I mean, he says, I'm old. You remember what Paul said? Remember what Paul said in Romans about Abraham? He said, I'm old and she's as good as dead, talking about Sarah. Now I'm old, but my wife, she's really, really, really old. We're talking about babies. Listen, babies can't come from me, can't come from, she's well in advance in her years. It can't happen. And see, so they had been praying and praying and praying and praying for a baby to come, a baby to come. And they'd been a stigma in society. And God, for some reason, in the sovereignty of his will, did not allow that to happen until now. Because you see, here's what's going to happen. I want you to notice the text. Verse 8. It's time for Messiah to come, Malachi says. Preceding Elijah would come one who is going to point toward the Savior. And so here's what's going to happen. The dice is going to fall on the Lord, keeps his covenant family. The sovereignty of man is going to overtake the chance. The sovereignty of God is going to overtake the chance takings of men. And the Lord keeps his covenant family. Because Elizabeth's name means is the oath, the covenant. And what Zechariah's name means, the Lord is faithful. So they're going to actually throw these dice, and they're going to see who it is that goes into the temple to burn incense, and it's going to fall on the Lord keeps his covenant family. You see, the people who've been keeping themselves pure, the people who have been walking blamelessly, I can't say this with enough zeal and passion and heart. Listen to me. Listen to me. Teenagers, listen to me. The world says, sell yourself in sex before you get married. And I'm telling you, walk with God and have integrity and don't do that. Don't go the way of the world. Walk blamelessly. Walk in an upright manner. Don't let some guy come to you and whisper that he loves you when he really just wants you and wants to use you and throw you away. Every parent, every grandparent ought to repeat that to their children, their grandchildren, because the world says, do this, but God says, no, I use people who are righteous and who are blameless and who are upright. And so Zacharias and Elizabeth were doing what they were supposed to be doing, or when they were supposed to be doing it, under the inspiration of God being active in their life. So the dice is going to fall. Verse 8, Zacharias' division was on duty. 18,000 priests roaming around. This is what they did near the temple. Near Passover, there were nearly 750,000 lambs that were slaughtered. These priests were covered in blood from their head all the way to their toes. That's all they knew was sacrifice. That's all they knew. They served the people. They gave wisdom. They gave counsel. But they were covered in blood, covered in blood, covered in blood. And so Zechariah gets an opportunity. It says, and he was serving. Look at it. I'm not making it up. As a priest before God, and he was chosen by lot. This is like the dice. It would be as if we had 800 people in here and the dice would fall on you and your family at this moment to do something for God. He was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. Let me give you a setup here. So what you would have is you would have the outer court, you would have the court of the Gentiles, and then you would have the court of the Israelites, and then you would go in and you would have the most holy place, and then you would have the Holy of Holies. So you would have these different layers going into the temple. And so two times a year, there would be a priest that would go in and serve his temple duty. And so Zechariah was a part of that. But not only that, but the dice fell on him to actually go into the temple and burn incense. Now, the Lord keeps his covenant family, and the dice are going to fall on him. Now, listen to me. In the Christian life, there's no such thing as luck. Take it out of your vocabulary. I was just lucky. You weren't lucky. You were blessed. You were blessed by God. When God chooses you and sets you apart for a holy work, he chooses holy people. That's what he was doing with Mary. When Mary, we'll see this the next weeks. Mary, when God's looking over the Jewish nation, he's got his binoculars out. And he's going, can't use her because of what she's done. Can't use, oh, wait a minute, there's somebody who's righteous. I can use her. Now, is God sovereign? Does he know everything? Absolutely. But God uses people who were holy, and these people were righteous. She was barren, and he goes to burn incense in the temple. So here he goes. He goes into the temple. Here's what it says. And when the time came, 10, for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. This is what they would do. They would pray for the Messiah to come. They would confess the sins of the nation of Israel. They would pray for their families. They would just pray. They would pray all kinds of things. They would confess. They would give praise and worship to God. So Zechariah's going in. Not only is he chosen, he's out of these 18,000 people, he's narrowed it down. He's there for his 2-week stint at the temple. And then he's chosen by lot to go in and burn incense. Wow. This is a story setting up the coming of the Messiah. They're praying outside. Then an angel, verse 11, stay with the text. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him. Oh, this is beautiful. This is God's breaking his silence. The darkness is moving into the dawn. Here comes God. He's been silent. Israel's been apostate. And now all of a sudden God says, it's time for Messiah, but there's a forerunner. I'm going to break my silence. So the angel of the Lord appeared at the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. What do you think you would do? I mean, do you think you would say, oh, what? No, you would be startled too. And this word fear in the Greek means a tremendous fear, a startling fear, a fear that you can't control, a phobia here. And so he was gripped with fear. And here's what happens. This is what happens in Scripture. Angels come, they give a voice, and people get scared. And then all of a sudden the angel says, but this is, I'm sent from God. Here's what the text says. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid. Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Now, that doesn't mean that they had been praying for a child when he went in to burn incense. That doesn't mean that at all. But all these years, they had been praying for a child. Maybe they had given up hope that they could ever have a child. Have some of you been there before? Maybe you've been praying for a miracle. And you said, that's it, God. I can't do it anymore. I can't pray anymore. It's just not going to happen. Well, see, sometimes God waits until we get to the end of ourselves, and then God says, here's what I'm going to do in my sovereignty, not my chance takings with men, but in my sovereignty. So here's Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He, this is what he describes John, he will be a joy and delight to you, and to many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit Wow, that's a mega answer. I've got a saved preborn baby. I mean, you talk about a baby dedication. I mean, he had taken a Nazarite vow, and this amazing what's happening here. So I've got a mega answer for you. You've been praying and praying and praying, but I'm going to blow you away with a mega answer. Verse 16. Many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Here's Zechariah's response. Put yourself in this scripture. Put yourself in the temple. Listen, let's go back and paint the picture a little further. So here it is. Zechariah's in the temple. He's made his way past certain areas. He's coming into the particular place. Now he couldn't go where the high priest would go. The high priest only one time a year at the Day of Atonement could go in to the Holy of Holies. So he's in the most holy place. He's got a golden bowl full of some hot coals, and he's making his way inside this particular area that is sacred to God, and it's where worship is going to come wafting out with the incense. And so he's in there, and he's got this angel who's come beside him and said, your prayer has been answered. And all he's thinking about, I just got to do my duty, because he knows what happened in Leviticus chapter 10 when I believe it was Nahum, and Abihu went in there. They got sliced out of there, and they started messing with the fire, and God just zapped them and took them out. And that's oftentimes why the high priest would go in with a skirt on with bells, because if he got to a certain point and started messing around in that temple, God would wipe him out. And the people outside know to have to put something under him so they could pull out a dead man, just pull him out of the temple, because what did he do? He blasphemed God in there. So you got to understand, Zechariah's going in there, and he's being very careful to do his duty. And he's getting to the place where he's got this golden bowl, and he's got these hot coals, and he just comes in to this holy place, and he lays down those coals, and he stirs the incense around, and he stirs the coals around, and all of a sudden the incense begins to go wafting out of the temple. And so people are outside praying and praying and praying. And listen, you don't stay long inside that temple. You get out of there. You get out of there as quick as you can, because the people want to know you're okay, and you want to know that you're okay. And so here's what happens. So the angel says, here's what the angel says. Prayer granted. You've been praying for a son. Prayer granted. And here's what Zechariah said. Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? How can this be? I'm old. My wife she's really, really old. How can this be? Has God ever done something in your life and you questioned him on the spot? How could this be, God? If at that moment he could have just said, oh, God, thank you so much. Oh, Gabriel, thank you so much for this answer. I've been praying for this. Thank you, God. Goodbye, angel. I got the message. I'm excited about this. And here's what he said. How can this be? How can you be sure of this? Here's what he says. I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years. Verse 19. The angel answered, I'm Gabriel. Here it is. I'm Gabriel. And I stand in the presence of God, and I've been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not be able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words. Zechariah didn't believe. He doubted God's word. Have you ever been there before where you questioned the promises of God? You questioned God. You doubted God. Wouldn't it be nice today if God shut people up like that? Who didn't believe him, because we'd know who they were. We'd be in church today, and you come up, and you wouldn't be able to speak, and I'd say, oh, boy, you've had it. God shut you up. We'd know who all of you were. But God doesn't do it that way, thankfully, because we may not have been able to sing this morning. Stay with the text. Here's what the angel is saying. The angel, Gabriel, was indignant with the response of Zacharias. Zechariah is in there. He's doing his priestly duty. We know he's already a responsible, a righteous man. He's doing his priestly duty, and the prophetic revelation comes, and he questions who God is. Have you ever been there? God, why? Why is this happening to me? Why is this happening? Can I trust you? How can this be? See, that's exactly what Zechariah did. How can this be? And the angel says, this is my paraphrase. God didn't waste his time by sending me. I didn't waste my time by coming. So don't you waste my time with that question. Don't waste my time with that question. And so that's what he was saying here. So he was silent and not able to speak until the day this happens because you did not believe my words. Verse 21. Meanwhile, here's the people. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. In fact, this is the first massive biblical timeout there's ever been. Time out, Zechariah. Time out. So here's this man. He gets this word. He's been praying and praying and praying and praying. Listen, Messiah's going to come. Messiah's coming onto the scene. All of the prophecy of the Old Testament is being fulfilled here. And Zacharias and Elizabeth are part of this prophecy and this fulfillment. God says, this is what's going to happen. John's going to be the forerunner. I'm going to give you a baby as a gift. And you're old, but God can bring babies when babies can't be brought because it's a spiritual thing. It's not necessarily a physical thing. It's a spiritual thing. So God can bring babies when babies can't be brought. So in order to show you this, I'm going to close your mouth and I'm going to open Elizabeth's womb. You're going to trust me, Zechariah, but it's going to be toward the end. You're going to see. I'm going to let you speak, but at the end of this. So the people are waiting. They're praying. What's wrong with this man? Why has he been in there so long? Has he blasphemed God? Did he cross over into the Holy of Holies where he wasn't supposed to be? Where are the bells? Oh, he's not the high priest. Okay, is he coming out of there? Is he coming out of there? Well, he comes out. And he comes out, and I'm sure the people wanted him to speak. And here's what the text says. Look at it, 22. When he came out, he could not speak to them. But they realized he had seen a vision in the temple. For he kept making signs. He didn't know sign language. He kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. Now, let me tell you what the standard benediction was for a priest when he fulfilled the duty of burning the incense in the temple at the altar. Here's what he did. Turn to Numbers chapter 6. Here was the standard benediction. Numbers chapter 6. Here's normally what a priest would do at that moment. They would all do this. They knew this by heart. The Lord bless you. Here's what Zechariah would have normally done. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Zechariah comes out. Go back to Luke. He can't speak. He can't say a word. God has done this work. It's a miraculous work. It's a miracle that God's going to bring babies when babies can't be brought. And Zacharias, because he didn't believe, because he didn't have faith, God shut him up. When he came out, 22, he could not speak. They realized he had seen a vision, for he kept making signs, but then remained unable to speak. Now think about this. Go back up to 20, verse 20. In the last part of verse 20, it says, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time. Now listen to me. God is sovereign. Stay with me. God's going to bring forth his purpose with or without you or me. You see, what happens when we forfeit our belief, we forfeit the right to be used by God in that situation. But God's sovereign plan are still going to take place because he said, in the proper time, I'm bringing this forth. This is Messiah's going to come. I'm going to bring him forth. John's going to be the forerunner. He's going to pave the way. In fact, John would say, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John would know that sacrificial system. And so he's pointing to the one, whoever the forerunner points to is the Messiah. So he says, behold, the Lamb who comes, who takes away the sins of the world. So these people, Zacharias and Elizabeth, knew the whole sacrificial system, all of these lambs, all of these altar slaughterings, slaughter after slaughter after slaughter after slaughter after slaughter, never took care of the sins of the nation of Israel, never took care of the individual sins of the people of God. And so therefore they had to point to one who would. And John says, behold, I'm going to be the forerunner. I'm going to point to him who's coming. So John was a forerunner. 23. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. I think Luke is careful to make sure that we understand that there's a miracle that's going to take place here. After this, I wish we would have had some detail here. It says this, after this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. At least Zacharias tested the Lord, because it says right here, and she became pregnant. God can bring babies when babies can't be brought. Listen, God can do something in your life, in your situation, when you think there's no more hope. When you think there is no way, God, I'm out of here, I'm done, it's over, I can't handle it anymore. Listen to me, just keep your eyes on Jesus, keep your eyes on Him, walk with Him, trust Him, believe Him. Understand that righteousness has been imputed to you and imparted to you, and you're to walk righteously and blamelessly before God, not before men. Keep heart, don't lose heart, Paul says in 2 Corinthians. So when his service was completed, he finished his priestly duties, she became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. Why was that? Here's why. Stay with me. Because if she would have went scamping around and saying, I'm pregnant in the sight of men, that she already was disgraced. So for 5 months, she just praised God and praised God and praised God. Oh, God, thank you for the blessing of this child. Oh, God, thank you for the blessing of this child. If our response to God is not in worship to Him for all that He's done to us, then what are we doing behind closed doors? She remained in seclusion because she knew that God had done something special. And she wasn't going to say thank you and goodbye. She remained in seclusion. So when she was able to speak, and by the way, she's going to be the one next week that's going to encourage Mary, who's going to get the same kind of word from an angel and says, you're with the Christ child. And she's going to say, I don't, but her response is going to be just a little bit different. Verse 25, here's what the text says. The Lord has done this for me, she said. In these days, He has shown His favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. What she was saying is, listen, God did a miracle. He did a miracle in my life. Zacharias is old. And I'm older than he is. But God is going to bring forth John, a mega answer to a prayer that we've been praying for a long time. Don't lose heart. Don't give up. Stay with it. And the Lord has taken away my disgrace among the people, because among the people she had a bad reputation. But now she's been in seclusion for 5 months. And now she's saying, oh, Lord, thank you, thank you, thank you. If God's blessing in our life doesn't drive us to praise and worship and honor Him, then what are we doing at church? We should be thankful for all that God is. He has shown His favor. He has taken away my great disgrace. I wonder today, in the next week, we just jump stories, 26. It was Gabriel who came again. So John, you have to lay the story of John beside the story of Jesus. You have to lay the Old Testament beside the New Testament. They're not in conflict. The Old Testament is not in conflict with the New. The Old Testament and the New fit together like a glove. And so we understand today that this is a crazy promise. This doesn't make any sense. Let me ask you a question in closing. What is it that God's been speaking to you about? And you say, this is crazy. I can't believe this. I need a miracle in my life. I need this in my life. God, what? Why? What? Believe God. Believe God that He's sovereign. He's sovereign over everything. He's sovereign over your life. And what you've got to ask yourself this morning is this question. Have you come into a relationship with Jesus Christ through faith? In the Old Testament, Zacharias, Elizabeth, Abraham, it was credited or counted unto them as righteousness. They look forward to what you and I look back on and understand, wait a minute, it's the same faith in the Old Testament. It's the same faith in the New Testament. The old and the new fit together like a glove. And if you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, Christmas time is a good time to do it. It's a good time to do it. Maybe you're here this morning, you say, man, I'm about to give up. I've had enough. I'm throwing in the towel. Could I just encourage you from this scripture? It took a long time for God to reveal His promise here. They probably weren't even looking for it. But God in His sovereignty overrode the chance takings of men. Wonder where you are today. Where do you need encouragement? Do you love Him? Do you like Him? Do you care about spiritual things? Because if you do, this is a word of encouragement for you. Would you bow your head with me and pray this morning? This story that most people skip over and start with the story we'll look at next week. You can't skip this story. Because this is how God broke the darkness. From Malachi to the point where he says, and the angel of the Lord appeared. Maybe you're here this morning and you feel that God is silent in your situation. Maybe you feel like, you know, I've been crying out and crying out and crying out and crying out. Your prayer hasn't been for a baby. Your prayer has maybe been for something in your marriage, with your children, a coworker, a situation that only God and you know. You've been crying out and crying out and crying out, and you're about ready to throw it in. Can I encourage you? Would you get your eyes off the situation and put them on Christ? Would you just trust him? Because really, the reality is some of you have maybe a bigger issue. You think, well, God can bring babies when babies can't be brought, but he can't bring this in my situation. Maybe he can do all things, but he may choose not to. But wouldn't it be sad if he told you to do something and you didn't believe his word and you didn't do it? And you were disobedient? Because I want to submit to you this morning that God was using Zacharias and Elizabeth. It says they walked blamelessly and they were righteous. And then there was that moment of doubt in Zacharias' life. And you say, well, God punished him. Well, God punished Jesus on the cross for all of our sin. It's been punished. It's been taken care for. God doesn't punish us. He disciplines us because we're his children, Hebrews says. He teaches us to trust him. He tells us to put one foot in front of the other. He lets you know when you get out of bed, like this morning, before your foot ever hits the floor, he owns the floor and the world that's therein. He owns it all. Maybe your heart is crushed and broken under the weight of something today. I'm going to ask you just to give it to Jesus. Let him minister to you. Let him touch you. Let him speak to you. Let him whisper to you how much he loves you, the plan that he has in your life. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you would, right where you are. We have some people that are going to be outside in our response room. If you go out these double doors, and you'll go out and you'll take a right. It's the first room on your left. It's called the hospitality room. And we want to help you. If you're here this morning and you need prayer or encouragement, I'm going to ask you to slip out and go right outside these double doors and go right into that hospitality room. Just a moment. Where you can receive prayer, you can receive encouragement. If you don't know Jesus, if you're saying, I'm not sure I'm saved, I'm another Christmas and I'm not sure I know the Christ of Christmas. Listen, we want to take the time to counsel you in the biblical things of God so you can walk out of here and know for sure that you're saved. Whatever decision you need to make, you want to join the church, that's the place to do it. We want to take time with you. So I would ask that those that are volunteering today, they'll make their way toward that response room. And if you're here right now and you'd like to go, I'm going to ask you just to come right now. Just come right down this aisle, come down that aisle, come out of the balcony and go straight to that room. There'll be somebody there. As Jeff plays, we don't need to sing. Anybody. Don't be afraid. Listen, fear will cause you to be paralyzed in your situation. Anybody? Let's pray. You can certainly, after the children sing, we're to close out with one song with the children as they have their musical. If you need to go during this prayer, just go right outside that door. After the service, just go right outside that door. Don't leave here. Don't leave here carrying a burden that you could release in the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray today that you would help us take what's been taught and put it in our lives in such a way that Jesus would be manifested. whatever decisions on somebody's heart. Lord, you know the hearts of the people in this room. We see people in the sight of men, but you see people in your sight, the sight of God. So I pray for people that are wrestling and having wars on the inside. Thank you for joining our broadcast today. The most important decision you'll ever make in your life is to trust Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and that's what our desire is for you. We can help you in any way if you will contact us at 982-2661 or go to our website at fbalcoa.org. God bless. Thank you.
Thank you. Tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down. Jesus.